Alright guys, so today I'm going to be showing you the final version of the F200 long range cross country racer. I'm sure we got to come up with some acronym to describe it, because it is a bit different from the normal one that you would be buying for lightweight mobility and travel. Alright, so you'd all be recognizing the F-Lite, the typical one I've always been flying, with the gravity feed tank at the top. Now this was the big development Nirvana had to complete, with a gravity feed tank of about 6 liters at the top and 10 liters at the bottom. And I have a valve system that I made, which is different from the one that you're going to be getting from Nirvana, as all their fuel lines are actually integrated and flows through the skeleton. Two blade configuration. I like the two blade configuration because I need that power to weight ratio. With the three blade, you get a lot better fuel economy figures. But the problem is that with the better fuel economy also comes a tad less thrust. And if you're a bigger guy flying heavier payloads, especially on the Icarus, you want to get airborne as quickly as possible. And therefore, that thrust is paramount. So I lose a little bit on the fuel economy, but I make up for it in being able to be effective when climbing to flight altitude and also getting out of really tight landing zones. Alright, so what you're noticing here is a standard Nirvana reserve tank, but this is no reserve tank on this trip. This is my cargo pod. Now, on the previous Icarus races, I always used side-mounted pockets or bags that gave me 10 liters of carrying capacity each. The problem with that is it obstructs the airflow when it comes around. The engine runs hotter, so I had to build a special piping system to redirect air and keep the engine cool. Now, all of that was possible, and that's what I did in the Icarus X, and the machine still performed valiantly. It was really, really good, but I did need that redirection of airflow to make it happen, otherwise the engine would overheat. But now, with the fuel tank, the reserve fuel tank, or twin tank being at the back of the machine, and also the reserve chute being at the bottom of the seat. That's another development Nirvana completed. With those two items moved away, there was no longer a reason to hold the reserve chute as a chest mount, as well as a bag with fuel and food and everything else in front of me. Now, in the past, the reason why I never used a chest-mounted tank or a chest-mounted bag, like, for example, Tucker God did in his Icarus races, was simply because I don't like flying with something that's not designed for the machine and also made out of complete material. So when you're flying and you're opening up the trims, you want to be aerodynamic. And if you've got something that's made solely out of material, it's flapping around all over you. And I even had a problem with the bags that I was flying that was side mounted. I did not like the material flapping around. So the idea was to take a container that was aerodynamic. So if you look inside, this used to be the 14 liter reserve tank from Nirvana, and I'm sure they'll be pissed if they see how I've cut it up. But the thing is it actually works so brilliantly because it keeps its shape, and it's aerodynamic, and your figures actually look a lot better. And when you take off and when you handle it, when you fly to places, get into tight spots, and it's something that's made for your rig. It's factory made to work with the rest of your machine. Then everything becomes a bit easier. You've got the radio and cell phone covers that fit onto the Velcro. Works like what I call a cockpit. And then right behind this back of, and over here, you have a 1.5 liter Camelback water reserve. So in a way, I've been able to put everything that I'm going to use onto the machine, and make it such that it's going to be easy to handle and it's not going to be an irritation. Now, this is one of the big things that you got to realize when you're doing cross-country racing. All the weight that you add onto your racing kit is extra weight that you've got to carry. So weight is a killer. In the beginning, I didn't really pay that much attention to weight. I just, you know, it was more like necessity. Do I need to this? Do I need that? Do I need that function? And I just pack it all in. And so for the first Icarus I did, I weighed 165 kilos all up with the Instinct 230. It's also a too heavy choice engine for my body weight. But everything I packed, wow, how I packed it was just crazy. For the next Icarus, I went down to the second Icarus I did was in the same rig. I actually did, yes, also, but I had said, yeah, it was the same rig. I just used a bigger glider. Then the third Icarus I did, I was on the air flight with the side mounted bags, and that was also really an improvement. I went down just by redesigning the kit and what I was taking with me, and the lighter air flight being used and better power to weight ratio, I was down to 134 kilos. So previous weight was 165, now I'm down to 134. And I reckon I'm gonna be even less with this rig because these items have been removed and they've just been placed in much better places on the rig. So I think I'm gonna have a much better usable rig, and that's all what it's about. If you want a great flying experience, things need to be accessible. All of the things that you need needs to be there, but you got to figure out somehow where it has to be stowed, and where's the best possible position where it's not going to bug you, or where you're going to lose things. Because boy, the first Icarus, every takeoff I did, I lost something. I either lost a knife, or I lost a battery pack, or I lost this, or I lost, just things just came off because it was designed to stick onto it. But if you run a lot because you're heavy, you're going to lose stuff. So I'm going to be doing a takeoff with this full rig today. I should be about, it's fully filled, got 15, 16 liters of fuel all up. Only thing that's missing from my container is the food pack, which we can cover a little bit later. And then that's pretty much it. This is pretty much the whole load for a race. We'll see what that looks like for takeoff. Yeah. All right, so that's what Icarus takeoff would look like with full fuel and full Icarus payload that's unsupported, sleeping bag, the whole lot, which is actually why I'm doing this next part now, is to show you all the elements that go inside that bag, which should be classified as the essentials, because let's face it, you could pack in a lot more in the 2018 Icarus. You know, I gotta say, I was over prepared because I had the same hot meals, but I had like little stoves, little kits of things that can fold up. And you know, when we there in the Kalahari, the Sao Pans, middle of nowhere, and we had to land because the wind speeds were picking up to around 65 kilometers per hour on the ground. Yeah, we stopped and we made a wind wall out of the wings, and I made a hot meal on the stove for me and Pavel. And then after that, we swallowed it down with a nice hot tea. Now, I don't really think that you need all that luxury. And in hindsight, I don't think I'd be packing that much anymore. I actually would just focus on the things that I've got on the table here, because like I said, it's all about weight. If you carry more weight, you've got to lug it around on the ground. The experience is less fun, is less enjoyable. So get the basics, and also remember that if you've got a lot of skill that you've developed over the years of being able to take off anywhere and fly anywhere, also means that you could fly and land near a restaurant and make use of a fast food chain rather than dig into your supplies. But nevertheless, all right, here we go with the stuff. So as mentioned, this is the sleeping the mattress, the inflatable mattress. Then I've got a towel and an inflatable cushion, so that comes in a nice compartment. Then the Sub-Zero sleeping bag. This is really, really handy. I think I wouldn't be able to do the Icarus without it. A lot of guys think that they're going to wrap themselves in their glider. They have horrible evenings, so that temperature dips between 0 and -5 degrees. And then the tent, a lot of designs out there. The only manufacturer that I know that makes one standard as a product offering is Abco. They actually make a nice tent that uses the frame of the Paramotor as the structure for the tent. But I got this one made by the Parajet guys here in South Africa, and when we were preparing for the first Icarus, they got a design and they've got someone that could make the make the glide, shape the material into the tent. All right. Right, let's get to the, okay, so tool-wise, I've got one multi-tool with a lot of extras, accessories on it that is pretty much the only tool that I take with. I used to take spanners and pliers and anything that you can imagine that, you know, from a mechanic point of view, if it breaks down in the field, I'm going to need to fix it. But after 3 Icarus races and not a single breakdown, it's just lugging tools along for what? Just this extra weight. So I'm just going to take a multi-tool for the very small things. Maybe a few cable ties cable straps or tie straps or whatever you call them. The Nirvana to me is just so so rugged and so durable that it's proven itself for me over 3 Icaruses that I don't need to carry a pack of tools. It's a touch wood that I didn't say that and something does bite me in the butt eventually. All right, flashlight. Okay, you need a headlamp. I think that is important because if you're flying to win on the Icarus, that means you're going to fly to the very last minute that you can stay in the air. They give you a certain time at sunrise, sunset, that if you fly after that, you're going to be disqualified. So when you land, you don't always have enough time to put up your tent, get everything done, and you're going to reach for that. And then also I use the light stick. The light stick is just nice. If you've got your tent folded up, you've still got activities outside, then you can just snap the light stick, shove it into your tent, and then continue on at servicing your motor, taking care of things. All right, so now we get down to the stuff that you really need to know. These are Goo, the Goo manufacturer. I believe you'll get them in other countries as well. I have a lot of knowledge about dietary requirements for racing because I do full-length cross-country marathons. And Goo is a very good product because what they focus on is not artificial highs that you'll get from glucose or sugars and or caffeine and things like that. So if you take one of these recovery drinks in the morning, you substitute almost 3 meals because it's got 5,200 amino acids in it. It's got sodium and it's got a lot of protein in it. So just it's going to fill you up. You're not going to want to eat anything else. If you're a really big guy and you're used to eating a lot, then maybe you'll take 2 of these shakes. But basically what I do is at takeoff, or the day before takeoff, I buy some milk, these little small milk cans, like a 500 or a 300 ml can. Take 2 swabs out of it, and then I just dump the powder into it the next morning before takeoff, and I know that I've got my meals covered for the whole day. But now we get to, I usually take 2 of these shakes, but then for the hot meals. Now, I like this product. I don't know if America or any of the other places have got equivalent of this. But what's nice about this product is the fact that it's a world-class meal in a packet. It's not like this typical camping dry meals or dry frozen foods. This is an actually cooked, this is beef and samp and beans and whatever else, all meshed up in that. And it actually, I can't tell you how much a difference it makes to have a hot meal if you've been flying for 10 hours. The difference to your psyche, it just makes you feel alive again if you're really, really tired or exhausted or you've been punished all day long by flying thermals. Having a hot meal makes a difference. Now, if I'm not taking a stove, how am I going to do this? So that it gets complicated there. I think that's... How am I going to solve that? Maybe I'll make a fire with some matches and then use a small little bowl that I'll be taking with, which is lightweight. I don't have it here though. And then you cook this in its container inside the bowl, but then it means you're going to have to make fire. The other great thing about it is if you do arrive at some place or some motel or a garage or a fuel station and they have a kettle, you can put this inside their kettle and it'll cook it up for you inside this little packet. You just dump this packet inside a kettle and by the time it cooks up, that thing will be hot and it's a hot meal that you have. So, am I going to pack an extra bottle up, a little pan or a little pot? I'm not sure. For the next race, I've got to think about that. I still have some space left and might make a decision on that. All right. Then the gels. These that you are actually what you want to use when you're flying. It kind of like reboots your system if you're getting really tired. It's also amino acids based and sodium, so there's no caffeine and no sugars in it, and you just pretty much just rip this off and take the gel while you're flying. So those are quite nice. And then never estimate these squeezable peanut butters. These things are fantastic. They are, you know, this is what I used to rehabilitate chimpanzees with that I've had to, like, with Auschwitz syndrome, where they've got no more muscles left. You just feed them peanut butter all day and the muscle rebuild is amazing. And it makes you feel good because it's all protein. Okay, last but not least. Now, in the Icarus, 2000, and that was the Icarus X in 2018, I believe. Yeah. And on takeoff, I lost my battery pack because the system I had at that point strapped everything on top with Velcro on top of the cockpit. And I lost it on takeoff, and I had a whole Icarus ahead of me. And that just made a big adventure for me. So I believe that now with this container, which I'm going to show once this is all packed back in, I hide the battery pack now inside the container. It's a very big battery pack. I don't need to access it all the time. I just have the cable sticking out and I can just plug that into the phone. So it's very important to hide as much of this stuff inside a package or whatever the container is that you are flying with. Because if anything sticks out or a wire catches on something or if something falls out of your pocket, that's stuff that you lose and you might not be able to replace that. I had to sleep in a field at that point, or in somebody's shed on a farm. Two old ladies, in actual fact. Let's not get into that. But the point is that I needed to use my kit and need to be effective, and I lost a whole bunch of stuff there. And unfortunately, they had power at that little farmhouse, and I was able to charge from one of their wall sockets. But it could have been a lot worse because I had no more navigation for where I was. All right, I'm going to pack this all back in and then just have a final look at it. All right, so when it's all assembled, this is what it'll be looking like. Got your phone that you'll be using for navigation, your music and communication with your ground, etc. Everything works perfectly fine with that. Your radio is stuck right next to that, and then you can put your computer gauge from your machine if you have that ability on your machine right next to that. Then your pipe you could push, and actually what works quite nice is you take the top off the tank off, the port, and then you could just get your water from here. Now, what I did not mention was that here's 1.5 liter Camelback that's in this pot. This whole thing, as it is here, weighs 5.5 kilos. All right, now 5.5 kilos actually sounds like a lot, but if you can imagine what's available to current pilots before we actually put this together, you would be putting 14 liters of fuel into your Camelback in this container that you'll be carrying on your chest. That would be around about 10 kilograms that you'd be carrying on your chest for takeoff. Then still you had your bags on the sides, which would be an additional five and a half, six, 7 kilos if it's accumulated, and then only your machine and the rest. So what have we achieved? We've cut down the weight down to the minimal that is required. We've made it aerodynamic. And number two, the fuel and the reserve chute are stowed in other places that creates less of a conflict with wires and gadgets and strings and handles and whatever else. Because when you fly into these really tight zones and have to take off again, you need something that is extremely user-friendly and won't get caught on risers and brake handles and whatever else, or during your pull-up that you step on something. Or this is what happened to me a few times on the Icarus. I had my reserve fuel tank line disconnect because it grabbed onto a riser pull-up because it comes out from the side. So too much weight and too many elements and too many products that you're trying to carry. The science is all about figuring out how we're going to make this easy. And I believe that from the Nirvana side, we've now created a package which is easy. It's nice to fly. I love flying cross-country now, unsupported. I'm not worried about something going wrong. The fuel is at the back. It's gravity feed tank. I'm not worried about what's coming my way, or that I'll be doing something accidental or lose something in the air. Guys, this is pretty much my last one for a while, and I'm hoping that if you got any questions, let me know, and I'll help you guys make sure that you put your kit together correct. Thanks a lot for watching, and please remember to subscribe.